Buenas tardes. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being here with us today. We have an amazing presentation, a walkthrough, and a little conversation today with the artist Liz Cohen behind me. Next to her is the amazing, iconic Lowrider model and just ordinary, phenomenal person, Dazza Del Rio. And next to Dazza is Bill. Bill Cherry is a Phoenix-based
fabricator.
He's been working with Liz on this project since the beginning. Bill is amazing, and he's gonna be in conversation with Liz. So quickly, I'm just gonna let you know what's gonna happen tonight. We're mapping the work and experiences Liz had in order to create this new exhibition. You will see video excerpts from different stages of this 10 plus year project. Here, discussions between Liz and our panel. Ask questions to Liz at any moment. You can do that on the chat, and we'll take some time at the end to do a Q&A. And also, if you have any questions for Dazza or Bill as well. You're gonna also see an exclusive premiere of this new exhibition and its creation. Hopefully book a time slot to see the exhibition in person. That's really important because you really have to be here to see the work. So let's start with our first video excerpt from Bikini Car Wash from 2002, which is the beginning of this project.
So
Toolbox, which is kind of unheard of. Thank you, Bill. And anyway, this is a photograph of us inside the shop. I did not work in bikini on the car, but I did want to show that Bill and Tommy how involved we are. And now let's go over the car, and Bill and I can talk a little bit about what it took to build it. So Billy, do you remember when I showed up at the shop? What was it like?
Yeah, I remember the car showing up at the shop.
It was not like?
Pilot parts.
Pilot parts?
Yeah. Same as new one of them. Yep.
Why'd you take me on? Why?
Yeah, I don't think I'll ever figure that one out. But...
So anyway, this car came to all the bodyworks. I've been working on it at Worldwide Customs in Oakland. And there was a big shift in the ideas for what was gonna happen with the car and the design of the car. And it really became a more complicated build because the Trabant had a little two-stroke engine in it, small kind of compact sedan. with the unibody construction, and I told Bill that I wanted to change the part of the car to a V8, to a Chevy small block, and that I wanted the car to get longer and shorter. And Bill, what happened?
Yeah, so it's not exactly something that's really easy to do, because you have to make the frame extend without pulling all the parts out of it, which is not made to do. So yeah, it took a lot of figuring out how to make all this stuff do what it does. Yep.
Do you remember teaching me how to use the tools? Was that frustrating?
Yeah, that was too much humor for me, but hard to teach somebody how to do something in 5 minutes that you spent 30 years doing.
That you did it and you were so patient. It was kind of amazing.
It's amazing, yeah. It is.
It is, right? And so basically, the technology that made this car possible. I mean, there's so much going on, that there's dual acting hydraulics in the frame. So this car was really built from the ground up. And so I had to build a chassis for the car, something that would hold the engine. And then the car was originally a front wheel drive. It had to become a rear wheel drive. So then there had to be a telescoping drive shaft, the telescope four times. And that took like, what, a year and a half or two to figure out the whole entire thing.
Well, it took a while to convince people that you could do that.
Yeah.
Because they all said the same thing. No, I'm sorry, you can't do that. Well, hold on here. This is what I need.
Yeah, and then we found a spline shop. We worked with Dick's Drive Shaft. We worked with an engineer in Chicago. I mean, it was like just that one section of the car was such a big part of the build. And then to get all the fuel to the back of the car when it extends, and to get the brake stuff to the back of the car when it extends, all the brake fluid, the gasoline, the electrical, the hydraulic fluid as the car gets longer and shorter, everything had to spiral and wind up and find a place to fit without getting crunched. So this white,
We crunched a lot of parts.
We did. We crunched a lot of parts. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that was one of the biggest challenges, right, Bill? How little space we have.
Damn. Well, you have no space. Everything is taken. There's no openings anywhere. You can't fit anything else in this thing.
Yeah.
When it's closed, it's completely filled.
Yeah.
There's nowhere to go. When it's open, it looks like you got all kinds of room.
Yeah, and so there were really kind of strict parameters that I had for building the car. There are some design elements. Like an important design element in a car is the wheelbase. And so this wheelbase of the Taban, I wanted it to extend to the wheelbase of an El Camino, so that's an exact measurement. The length of the Taban had to extend to the length of a 1973 El Camino. It had to have a Chevy small block. You see the color. This is the original Taban color. And then when you look at these floor tiles, you have the Chevy orange and the white. And there's a lot of orange in the engine compartment as well, the Chevy orange. And so there's a lot of technology going on here and retaining some of the identity of the Taban through things like the gas tank. That's still there, and so here you can see the hydraulic pump system that drives the transformation of the car. So here you have the center pump makes the car get longer and shorter with the dual acting hydraulic, and then the outer motors are working the hydraulics in the suspension. So you've got the front and the back, and it goes up and down, and the car goes in and out. And so it does all of the kind of
Lowrider
tricks, and it drives. And if you point down here to the drive shaft, you can see that I was talking about before, this balance is short and long. The car can drive at freeway speeds in the short form and the long form. So that was very important to me, that the car would actually be a functioning vehicle and not just a static sculpture. It had to be
a kinetic sculpture, and it had to function. It had to really retain the function of a car, of an automobile. Like I said, this is the Trabant gas tank. So you have a very little gas tank, you know, for Chevy, like for a V8. So you have, I think this gas tank holds how many gallons?
5 gallons.
5 gallons. He has a 5 gallon yeah. tank. And so, you know, you have to refill it a bit.
8 miles to
that gas street.
It doesn't last that long. And so if we come over here, this is a video of, well, actually, let's look at this. Billy, come here. Come over here. So, Bill, come here. Do you remember these?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, they're all patterns.
Patterns for what?
Patterns to make parts.
Yeah, patterns to make parts for cutting out metal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is all stuff that he's used
pieces,
for.
Floor pieces,
yeah, floor work, the tunnel, yeah, the council pieces. So these are all stencils that for the, you know, metal fabrication in the car that I'd save over time. And they're kind of strung up here, little tapestry. And this is just some ephemera from kind of the time period of building the car. Some shirts from the different shops I worked at or suppliers. This was LDN tuning in Plauen, Germany. They were awesome. I got a lot of Trabant parts from them. And when we shot in Zwickau, these photos behind me, they lent us a Trabant and a bunch of parts. So anyway, here are some car manuals, automotive technology textbook. Some pins and car parts. And then over here is the test drive of the car in Texas. So this is the first time that the car was driven long distance. And the car was driven from Marfa, Texas, from Ballroom, Marfa, to the Mexican border. It was a caravan. You see the Trabant, and it's being followed by a 1973 Chevy El Camino, which is the car that the Trabant is aspiring to become. And
border patrol, wondering what the hell we're doing.
There's the border patrol. We did a little clowning to let them know what we were thinking. And then the styling for this shoot, I was thinking a lot about Liz Taylor's Giant and Lola like Brailera, and so a whole bunch of different kind of references to things as I was thinking about how I was going to put this together. But you can see the car's going at freeway speeds. I think we're going 75. And it does its thing.
And so, Liz, there's a couple of little questions here.
Okay.
Adrian Jenick asks, did you take the car to Lowrider shows?
I did.
We didn't show the plaques.
Yeah, so let's walk over here. So I did go on a tour, and I competed in Lowrider shows, and you can see that at the first super show I went to in Española, it's Española is the lowrider capital of the world, and I went to the Main Street Showdown, and I got first place in my category, Compact Radical, and then I got an honorable mention for the show. It was like just an amazing experience and a total honor. To be there, and that's some of the kind of really great lowrider builders. And then I competed in Fresno as well. And so, yeah, I've been to the lowrider shows, and incredible experience. And I mean, I had been going to shows for, I mean, I don't know, 15 years before I competed. And so it was kind of terrifying and really exciting. And yes, I did compete in lowrider shows.
And so now we're gonna have a brief moment, and we're gonna actually look at Liz working on the actual Trabant car in Bill's in his shop. So we'll take a short minute, and Kat's gonna play that for us. Oh, Worldwide Customs. Yeah. Okay, sorry about that.
That's okay.
So we're gonna watch that right now, and then we'll go up to the next floor to the next segment of the exhibition.
Fabulous.
Thank you.
today. I tell you, dark hair, long, makeup, tight clothes, about it.
So This is the timeline that the education department at the ASU Art Museum put together for the exhibition, and it's so groovy, I'm very into it. So the timeline has various categories: women's rights, female bodies and car culture, Cold War key dates, cars, El Camino, Costa Bont, Lowriders, and me. And basically it's a timeline that weaves together the histories of kind of all the threads, all the themes and layers and the projects. And so it's pretty exciting. And I'll just point out a few things. This is something to really come see in person. I think it's pretty fabulous. So anyway, I'll stop right here at this image of Lisa Lyon's Body Magic. Lisa Lyon is one of my heroes. I consider her a muse. And Lisa Lyon was an artist. She's been, I believe, a curator at the Walker Art Center. She was Robert Mapplethorpe's most photographed subject. She was the first championship woman's bodybuilder in the world. So she was the first world champion. Here you can see the photograph, one of the photographs of her taken by Robert Mapplethorpe. Remember this one because we're going to go see some stuff with that was shot. The kind of course, this is where the name of the show comes from, Body Magic. And I'm going to be there in that section of the show with Dazza, who's really like my muse, mentor as a model, as just someone that moves in front of the camera and understands how to. I've watched Dazza for 20 years.
I have watched you move for 20 years.
And here's Dazza. You see right here, this is when I met Dazza Del Rio in Fresno.
This is amazing. This is on your screensaver.
Yeah.
And I never saw this. That's like amazing.
Yeah, so I met Dazza at the Fresno show in 2003. Kind of a tough show. I mean, of car shows, and I went. I like knew who Dazza was, and I wanted to see her booth in the kind of show area. And she was selling her merch, and she was with her mama, and I started talking to her. And she asked me if I'd go to the bathroom with her, and it was pretty exciting. And so we talked. And then, you know, many years later, we got back in touch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I didn't know you were doing all building cars in between.
Yeah.
Were you, did you build, at this point, were you already building cars?
I was starting.
She was starting.
I was starting,
and
yeah.
You were a baby.
Yeah, I was a baby.
And tiny and little to be building cars and doing all kinds of dangerous things.
Well, when there's a will, there's no way. all right, so let's come around over here and we'll look at a series of photographs called Stories Told by Others. And Stories Told by Others is my effort to recognize the women in lowriding that were on the covers of the magazines and their incredible contribution to the style and attitude of lowriding. And I'll show you one of the very special photographs. Dazza in Japan. Hello. So Dazza, do you have a story about this?
Well, so that was the first time ever that Lowrider went to Japan. So that was 1997, and I was also singing at the time. And that was the first time I ever left the United States or even Orange County. Maybe I was like a little bit of LA. And yeah, it was a culture shock. But it was interesting because when I went to Japan, basically the Japanese looked like more like cholos than our own cholos. Like they had it to the T. They had the zoot suit look going on. They had like hairnets. They also had the best lowriders because they would come to the shows and purchase the best lowriders, which would be like twice as much, two or three times more than it would be here, and they shipped them back. And I think they still have a lot of like classic, famous lowriders. So, yeah, it was a great time. It was a great experience, and lowriders still super huge in Japan.
Yeah,
yeah, it's a big, big scene over there.
Do you want to talk about the names?
Okay, and so one of the things that is really special about this project If you look at some of the photographs here, you can see the hand lettering. So this is enamel paint, like enamel lettering. And this is done by Bugs Gonzalez, who's a Mesa, Brian Gonzalez. And he is one of the great pinstripers and painters in lowriding. I mean, Bugs is amazing. So it's a kind of a great honor that I can have him paint the names on these photographs. And they're just beautifully, beautifully done. Thanks, Bugs. So these photographs are of Dazza and I channeling the spirit of Lucy Lyon. And they are inspired by some of the Maple photographs, but really by Lisa herself and her attitude and style in the images. And for me, both Dazza and Lisa Lyon are these kind of ideal forms that I've looked to over time. You know, thinking about Lisa Lyon working on her body and the kind of method acting that it took for her, if that's what it was, but or just, you know, working out, becoming this world champion bodybuilder. And I think she only competed once as a performance artist, as an artist. And then Dazza as this icon of lowriding, who is really someone who I would say is like the Madonna of lowriding, who has created a whole enterprise around herself and a brand. And if you see, or at least for me, when I see Dazza photographed, and I've seen her in action many times, there's the dynamic between the photographer and the model. And Dazza's half a second ahead of the photographer, positioning herself in front of the camera, and it's an incredible exercise of control and personality, and it's like incredible. So thank you, Dazza.
Well, this was a very different photo shoot for me, because I'm used to doing like pinup and car shoots, this and that, but I mean, this really, we really had to become Lisa.
Yeah.
And the transformation that you did, 2 years of literally training to get to that point. I mean, the running, the exercises, the weight training. I mean, it wasn't just like you just showed up and you get like, you really embodied Lisa and you took the time and created her image. And I mean, I'm really proud of you. You did a great job.
I'm so honored that you even entertain the idea of doing this with me.
I was, remember when I saw first, I was like, wait a minute, this isn't pinup. And you're like, no, it's not pinup. But I'm like, you know what? I'm so happy that I did it, because this is something that I never would have done, but you really had to become a character. And it was very much model method acting. It was a very dramatic shoot, and it was hours. I mean, I think the first day was like 14 hours.
Yeah, we did 3 days.
Yeah, like nonstop. It was extreme, but it was awesome. The photos show you that they are.
Well, thank you. I mean, it was really.
It was a huge teamwork. You should explain what each one is.
Well, they're all, I mean, again, they're like the outfits are inspired by some of those photographs that were shot by Maple Corp. And we have this incredible stylist, Danielle, who did our hair and makeup. There are these automotive suedes in the background. These automotive suedes are called synergy suedes. And those are kind of in the background. And
I mean, but look at this body. That's a lot of work. I mean,
it doesn't even get close to what Lisa Lyon did, but we try.
But yeah, but I mean.
But in any case, you know, we played with that, and it was a starting point. Those photographs were a starting point, and then being with Dazza was just like a huge experience for me in terms of being in front of the camera and taking cues from Dazza on how to pose. It's not natural for me to achieve these kinds of poses and to understand how to do it. And so being next to Dazza and feeling her kind of vibe and seeing her body and her instructing me, like, pop it out, get it up. Wait, what is it that you say when you see the camera? What is it, Julio?
What was he saying?
I'm ready. What is it?
I'm here, I'm ready.
I'm here, I'm ready.
Yeah, you talk to the camera. I do.
Oh my God.
No. Are you ready for me?
Oh yeah, are you ready for me? Are you ready for me?
And speaking of that, can we turn around and actually look at the video of not the making of, but basically you can see the actual photo shoot here. So it's a 6-minute video that Liz put together of the whole 3 days of shooting Dazza and Liz herself.
So, you know, the looks are really like 80s, kind of Madonna.
So obviously the shoots at this time period was from the 80s, so the looks are 80s inspired, right?
Wouldn't you say? Yeah, so, you know, there are also historical references like Diana and
the good poses. They're not easy to do. I mean, I found them very difficult because these are bodybuilding poses and they also.
What was the hardest part in the shoot itself? Was it the poses, the duration?
I don't know. I mean, it was fun too. I mean,
it was super fun, but it was not an actual, like, when you do a photo shoot, you're kind of shooting for a product or you're shooting an image that you create yourself because you're the image. But when you're reenacting someone else's images and you are to be that person, you have to really, mentally, I had to let go of everything and be like, look, this is someone's legacy that I'm recreating.
Yeah.
And that's what, you know, I mean, I think, I know you know this. So, and the video is amazing, which she edited 15 hours a day to get. And then we did this whole spoof about, we were trying to figure out how to do a TikTok because I had no idea. And so I was like, I'm Lisa.
I'm Lisa.
So she ended up being able to use that, the wordage of that in the video. And that's what you're hearing over and over again.
Yeah. So, and you're hearing, I mean, Daz is kind of a natural actor too. So you're hearing her. I'm kind of quote things like, I'm here, Studio 54. I mean, the whole whatever.
What is your favorite photograph from the shoot?
I think this image of Dazza right here.
We saw the timeline.
And for me, really, when I started talking to Dazza about doing this, we reconnected again a couple years ago. Dazza had just lost her husband, and so for me, I hope that's not too mine right now.
No, it's fine.
And so for me, this image was very much of like a mourner, and so this was really important to me as I was picking, kind of, you know, finding clothing and stuff online to use for the shoot. I was really thinking a lot about Dazza as I was thinking about this image and coming back into her life at such a difficult time and kind of talking with her over the 2-year period.
It's a very profound image for myself too, because that the 2 years to come was like the worst 2 years of my life. So this was a very powerful piece for me. I love it.
Thank you for doing it, for taking it on.
And I believe now we're gonna watch an excerpt from your
fabulous
hydro.
Okay, yeah.
And we'll come back in a short couple of minutes after the excerpt of the other video that's in this gallery, and we'll go into Q&A.
Thank you.
Okay. You want me to do it? Welcome back.
So there are a lot of really interesting questions coming in, and I hope that on the fly here we give some hopefully interesting answers. So the first question I'm seeing here is, Liz, in terms of your project's documentation, how do you view judge the line between female empowerment and female objectification? I mean, that's really complicated. You know, I think that I'm someone that, you know, tries to be like sex positive and body positive and really kind of embrace the full range of what it means to be a human, even in the kind of part that has to do with sex appeal and like self-satisfaction with the body. And so I think, you know, I think that the line is crossed, and I think that sometimes we do things for ourselves and sometimes we do things for others, and that's a complicated dynamic, right? And so I think, you know, there has to be a balance, and, you know, it has to be, the desires have to be empowering, right? They have to serve, I mean, for me, they have to serve the, like, woman's body who's using that body. And so, you know, I've never think it's been, like, a clear-cut thing that, like, a certain way of using one's body is clearly bad, a certain way of using one's body is clearly good. I think a lot of times it's very nuanced depending on who's doing whatever they're doing. So I don't know how that answers the question, but I thought it would be interesting to hear Dazza talk about that as well, as someone who's used your body as your profession your whole entire career.
Right. You know, that question to me is very irrelevant, because I feel like everyone uses their body for whatever they need to do. You know, if a man uses their body to physically work on a car, that's okay. If a woman uses her body to physically wear a bikini and work on the car, she's being judged because she's using her femininity and she's working at the same time. Like, we always get to be judged if we show our body. And to me, like, that question is just so annoying, because we're always judged. Women are always judged if we're wearing this, if we're doing that. But at this point in time, I think we just need to get over that now.
Well, I think we have an opportunity to be playful too, right? There's so many kind of images that already exist and kind of are kind of card catalog of images in our mind culturally. Like, the image of the bikini model already exists. There's an opportunity to play with it, you know, which is kind of the attitude I've always had, is how do we play with pre-existing images?
I mean, I love the bikini and the masculine and the feminine working together. That's when I was saying, like, how you were working on a car in your bikini. I love that. It's like you're showing
for the photographs. I didn't really.
No, but I mean, you don't really do it. I would have. But then again, I'm not a work on this.
So I know you would have, and you would have done it successfully.
Oh, I would have wore heels too.
Yeah. Okay, here's another question. Who owns the Trebontomino now? I do.
Yay!
And can you talk about your relationship to, or your experience of joy and pleasure in your work, particularly bikini car wash? Well, you know, bikini car wash was really, it was the introduction to the project, and before that work, I had been doing work with sex workers along the fringe of the U.S. Canal Zone in Panama City, and I was thinking a lot about using the body to make money, and I wanted to raise some money to buy a car, and so I did this bikini car wash on 19th Street and Cap. 19th and Cap in San Francisco, and it was, on the one hand, I was wearing these crazy platform heels for 6 hours, washing these cars. I think I washed 40 cars. And so, I mean, there was a part of it that was painful, but it was also really exciting. It was exciting to see people engage, with the car wash and actually having a lot of fun with it. I was surrounded by people I really love, you know, a lot of friends. My sister was there, the gallery space itself, a friend, Adam Nolan, had just opened it, and a friend, Patrick Rock, was selling hot dogs, and Mitchell Denny did my hair and makeup, and he was in Amsterdam. I mean, it was just like, it was so much love there.
But that was in Amsterdam?
No, that was in San Francisco. And so, like, I mean, there was like pleasure in engaging with people. It was, this is a hard question. It's a really good question. I don't know if I answered it. Okay, Dazza, this one's for you. Do you remember your first Lowrider event? And do you have a favorite memory from the Lowrider days?
My first Lowrider event would have not been, it wouldn't have been Lowrider Magazine. My first Lowrider event was, when these girls from Orange County, basically, quickly, when these girls from Garden Grove, these white girls actually, they were white cholas, and they went to Orange County, and they were going to my school, and they were going to a Lowrider show, and they decided to want me to look more like that. So they took my hair. My hair has always basically been the same, by the way. I've never changed my hair. Okay, I'm getting very sexy today, aren't I? So they took my bangs, they cut it across, they ratted it, they aquanetted all my hair, they threw me in spandex, they took me to the Lowrider show in the LA Coliseum. And that was my first time ever seeing a Lowrider show, ever seeing Lowrider cars, ever even getting out of Orange County. Was that. That was my first show. My and then like a year later, I started singing for Lowrider Thump Records. So that was my first time going to a show.
What was your first, like really, like your first concert? I love this story.
My first concert was when I was singing?
Yeah.
Okay, so my first concert was with Thump Records, and I did the car show, then I met a guy named Angel, and he wanted me to go to the Lowrider Christmas party. So I went to Lowrider, I had to convince my mom to take me because I was like almost 16. Almost, can you imagine? And so my sister drove and went to Long Beach, and I was singing a Lisa song, and then Lowrider, one of the guys from Lowrider, Larry, he like said who's singing. I was singing by the boys' bathroom, shocking. And then a week later, I was in the studio, and then 6 months later, I was opening up for Ice Cube at the Coliseum. And that was my first time performing, singing, anything.
Total natural.
First time doing anything with my dancers that I found at an underground club. So that was my first. But probably, that would have been my best memory, opening up for Ice Cube.
Okay. So here's another question. How did the body work you did on your own body simultaneously change your relationship with your body? Did it? Our culture equates thin, et cetera, with confidence. Was that your experience? If so, did it come from achieving the form in itself or from the increased attention control you were able to exercise over your body?
That is a great question.
Yeah, okay. I mean, it's interesting because I've always been, I don't know, maybe a little boyish or whatever. And I think that with the projects, I end up having the opportunity to try out just different ways of being, you know? So when I was working in Panama, I remember Lynette, one of the people I was photographing, just one day was like, okay, I need to redress you. I want to make you look sexier. And that was such a wild, I remember it being, I just hadn't seen myself that way before. And it was really kind of exhilarating. And then that kind of led into this work for many reasons. And then, I don't know, in a way, like I kind of made a decision that I wanted to get into the custom car world through various avenues, building the car, being the car owner, being the model, because I knew those were various roles that were important. And so in a way, it was very practical. As an artist, like I kind of separate my, I mean, I'm an analytic person. So in some ways I decide I'm going to do something and I'm doing it. But then, you know, you're walking in the world and you're having a regular life and.
You have many dimensions.
So, I mean, I'm not going to lie. It feels great to be fit and to be, you know, probably like preparing for this shoot with Dazza, for example. You know, I had a kid 9 years ago. I've been working, you know, just hard as an educator. I've moved during that time period, and I just, you know, I hadn't spent that much time concentrating, I guess, on myself. And so it was really an opportunity to get in shape and really take care of myself. So I mean, that's satisfying, right? So it feels good to be fit, feels good to be healthy. I don't know if I'm really answering.
Well, I think you are answering, because also, because I was talking to you, the amount of, like, you were running and stuff. So I think psychologically, this was good timing. Because of COVID, you were able to go out, your dog.
Oh yeah, I got a dog.
She got a dog.
We run together, we hike together.
Yeah, and it was really, I think it mentally it helped you, because you were doing the show, you were getting exercise, you're going outside, and you're working on yeah. the show at the same time. And looking great too. I mean, how you transformed, it's incredible.
But I mean, honestly, a lot of it's really analytic and, like, in a weird way, very practical. Like, it's just a way of achieving a certain form.
One more question.
Okay. Oh, here's a question from Shada Soleimani. Liz, and then it says some nice things about the show. And then I was wondering if you could talk about your process of how you create your images and how your research integrates into how they are made, specifically how you decide to use the camera as a tool to record, document. Also, hi, Dazza.
Hi.
So, I mean, I do spend a lot of time. I mean, I'm interested in geopolitics. I'm interested in ethical theory. I'm interested in group responsibility. I'm interested in the ways people belong. You know, I'm interested in the history of photography and the history of art. And so when I start doing a project, I start to research various threads. So for example, while I was building the car, I was reading a lot about East Germany. I was reading about Trabant. I was reading about El Camino. So I was reading about the Cold War. I was drawing from my own personal experiences, having traveled with my family to the USSR and China as a child, and growing up in the 80s and having these kind of very Cold War heroes like Nadia Comaneci and Mary Lou Retton. So anyways, I start just looking deeper and deeper into those things, and I start looking at a lot of different kinds of photography, a lot of different kinds of art, and I start to just surround myself by those things as I'm thinking. And, you know, things evolve too. I work on projects for a long time, and so different things come in and out. Every piece is a little different. I hope that answers the question.
Yes. Yeah. And I want to thank everyone again, all our special phenomenal guests, Dazza and Bill. Thank you so much for being part of our
thank you for putting it together. It's such an honor. Thank you.
Thank you. Julio.
Thank you to all the staff at the ASU Art Museum. Yes. Thank you to Nikki, the director, and Julio especially. Thank you so much for believing in me.
It's a beautiful, phenomenal show, and I hope everyone can come and see it in person. So we're going to close off the opening online reception with our Wingate fellow, DM, that is, she also, not only is she an art history student, she also is a car customized.
She's a master technician.
Exactly.
She's a journeywoman for sure.
That's a long one to remember, but she's phenomenal, and she helped set up the exhibition with us as well. And so we're gonna go into a short video of DM going into the actual car and letting you know how everything in the car works. So thank you again for joining us tonight, and we'll see you soon.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Diem Lanakai. I am currently a Wingate Fellow here at ASU Art Museum. I have been excited for Liz's show because of my own personal background. I currently am a graduate student here working in art history at ASU. And during my course as a graduate student, I got to see Liz give us a lecture about her show. And for me, what made it so exciting was the fact that my own background is that I am a ASC certified master technician. I've worked in the automotive field for over 20 years as not only as a technician, which means I work on cars, also as a service advisor and a parts consultant. Because I am a graduate student here at ASU and I am also teaching automotive at the same time, this is the most exciting time for me to be able to explore both sides, almost like two hemispheres of my brain, and mirror the two together. So Liz's show has given me the opportunity in which to do this. Now, as I'm going through Liz's show and learning how she has put together this vehicle, all it's done is make me even more excited, because for me, a vehicle is the most majestic type of machinery out there. I look at all kinds of different machinery and I can appreciate the knowledge and engineering that goes into it. But when you build a machine from scratch, this is not taking a vehicle and going, I'm just going to add a little bit here and a little bit there. This is actually a ground up installation of a vehicle, not just taking pieces and bits, but actually taking a concept. And with that concept, you're creating the vehicle pretty much from scratch, no different than if you're creating a painting. You're gonna go ahead and have this concept, make the sketch, and then put the oils on the canvas. That's the same thing with this vehicle. And with this vehicle, we can actually explore the different concepts that she put together. So for us, in the automotive field, to us, this is not a custom car. This is not an art car. This is a concept car. So when manufacturers first begin putting cars out before a new model comes out, the designers have to go through, come up with these concepts, work with industry professionals and designers and engineers in order to create this concept, and it's usually a one-off, and that's exactly what Liz has created here. For me, the heart of this vehicle is the engine. So I'm going to open the hood here. We can take a look at what is the heart of the vehicle. Liz has gone through and drawn upon her hot rod legacy by installing a Chevy small block 350 cubic inch V8 8-cylinder engine into her Trabant. So if you think about a riding lawnmower, riding lawnmower, you're putting in about 40 to 60 horsepower to ride around on. When the Trabant was first created, that's about the same amount of horsepower that was putting out, except in a riding lawnmower, you got one person. The Trabant, you're putting four people in to ride around in. When you put a 350 in here, you're looking around in the neighborhoods of 300 horses. So when she went and created this, she wanted to put in here into the hot rod culture by building a performance engine. As we can see with the Elderbrock carburetor, it's a four-barrel carburetor that feeds fuel into this engine. And then she goes and brings it a step up. I use a stainless steel. Stainless steel is the best item to use. Not only does it look pretty, but it has a higher pressure so that it doesn't matter what you do with it, it's less likely to break down on you. She has this custom four-core radiator built specifically for this vehicle. So this way, this engine, no matter where you're going or what you're doing, there's not going to be any issues with it overheating. Now, the other thing that I find most exciting about this vehicle is that she, drawing upon the El Camino culture, which is more a hot rod culture than pretty much thinking of it as a sedan. When the El Camino first came out, it was not very successful because they were marketing to the wrong market. As soon as they put the 350 into the El Camino and you were able to use more horsepower and they redesigned it in the second generation, that's when the El Camino really took off. And so we have the hot rod underneath the hood. So in the hot rod culture, if you have a really small car with a large engine, then that's more of a sleeper vehicle. In other words, you do not expect this vehicle to have that kind of horsepower. The lowrider culture is opposite of hot rod culture, which is all about speed. How fast can we go? How much horsepower can we have? Where a lowrider culture, it literally is low and slow. So drawing upon that side of her heritage, Liz went ahead and decided that we need hydraulics. So what we look here is a custom setup of her pumps. So we have the motors, which were the same size as if you were looking at a starter motor. Due to the advancement in technology, these motors would be standard on any 350 built in the 70s. The 350 came out in 1968, so this would be the standard type of electric motor that you would see on the actual engine itself. Heavy vehicles, and that was part of what's making them so heavy. These motors were about 25 to 30 pounds just for the starter. So she has three of those sitting here, so we're adding weight to the rear of the vehicle, which is good, because that gives her traction for how much horsepower that she has coming out of that engine. She built a custom tank, so she's got some fabrication going on. She has to run all her lines, and every single inch of this vehicle has to be thought out in advance for this all to work. Now, we have lowrider, we have sleeper, we have hot rod, and now we're going to what we would call concept. She wanted the vehicle to actually not only use the hydraulics as lowrider culture does, which moves the vehicle up and down, but she also wanted to extend it, which is rather unusual in lowrider culture. So she had to custom build this frame so that it would slide in and out of the vehicle. Now once she built this frame, in order to get power from the engine to the rear drive wheels. So your powertrain, you have your engine, the power goes through the transmission, through the drive line, it's split in the differential and out to each wheel. Well, when you extend the vehicle, how is that power moving from the engine to the rear differential? Well, that's where you have to have a drive line that can move. The most marvelous feat of engineering on this vehicle for me as an automotive person is the drive line. For the drive line to work, it has to be balanced. If it's not balanced, because if you think about it, if you're spinning around and you fall off balance, you fall over. Well, the same idea with the drive line. Since it's moving at such a high rate of speed as it's spinning, or RPM, revolution per minute, it needs to be perfectly balanced. Now, that's hard enough to do when you're dealing with a drive shaft or propeller shaft that's 4 to 5 feet long. What Liz is dealing with here is 1, 2, 3, 4 sections of her drive shaft. Now, each individual section has to be balanced so this way that each section can rotate without any vibration. Then after you get all that done, then you have to put it all together and make sure the whole assembly rotates without any vibration for 4 sections. And after you do all that, as the car comes apart with the hydraulics based upon her 2 rams, she has to make sure that once it apart, it is also balanced as each section is elongated. For me, that is so amazing. Half the time, we can't even get people to balance tires correctly so that they don't work without vibration. That being able to do a whole drive shaft for a vehicle that is balanced when it's closed or collapsed, and when it's expanded, it still is in balance. For me, that is just marvelous. You have to work with engineers, you have to work with designers, in addition to industry professionals that actually can machine this type of drive shaft. For me, it is spectacular. And then we have to deal with hydraulics. So she has 2 large hydraulic rams here. Believe it or not, hydraulics are actually very common. Every time you open a door, or even your screen door, and you open it up and it very slowly closes, that's the hydraulic cylinder above you. People think that pumping on your brakes or using your steering, that's the only type of hydraulics. Well, actually, every time you open up your trunk and it stays up, that's another form of hydraulics. So what we've done, or I say what she's done with hydraulics, or what you can do with hydraulics, is actually expand it to whatever you can create. Whether we're dealing with large machinery, or we can take a vehicle, have it raise up in the back, raise up in the rear, or raise up in the front, and then drop down, or actually extend it. So as long as you have the right cylinders and you understand the concept of how hydraulics work, you can make them do anything you wish. What's so exciting about this one is she has a double acting cylinder here. So we have the cylinder and we have the ram, and then there's a piston on the inside that allows the pumps to move the fluid forward or to move the fluid back, and allowing her to move this back and forth. So we have this moving component on this vehicle. So you have to think about, where's my electrical wires at? So you have to have enough room for that. So that's a lot of planning. And then you have to think, well, I need brakes in the back, and now that I've extended it, so you have to think about hydraulic wiring. And then you're like, well, how do I get the fluid from the front to the back if I have it extended? Well, then you have to think about, how am I going to run the plumbing for the hydraulics? So every single step that she has done has had to be planned out. Much like when you start off with a sketch, you have a concept of it, but as you go through, things change, things modify, because you may think this is going to work this way and it doesn't, and then you have to change things for it to be modified, and then this way it works that way. So this requires the input of different industry professionals. You're talking about people that know electrical, you're talking about people that know hydraulics, you're talking about people that understand welding, then you have to talk about body panels. So it's really a conglomerate. You use a lot of information, because there's no one person that can take a vehicle and do every single thing to build a vehicle correctly by themselves. There always has to have outside help. So looking at this vehicle from an automotive standpoint, it's spectacular. Everything from having all the chrome done to it, from the hydraulics to the electrical system, and of course, my favorite part, the Chevy 350 V8.